Pendulum. How past generations shape our present and predict our future. By Roy H. Williams and Michael R. Drew. Narrated by Roy H. Williams and Michael R. Drew. Copyright 2012 by Roy H. Williams and Michael R. Drew. This unabridged audiobook is published by arrangement with Vanguard Press, a member of the Perseus Books Group, and was produced in the year 2012 by Tantor Media Incorporated, which holds the copyright thereto. This audiobook is packaged with bonus material which has been included on the first audio and MP3 CD. If you downloaded this audiobook in digital format, please visit our website at tantor.com and type Pendulum in the search box. Follow the link to the book's page, then click PDF Extra 1. When prompted, enter the access code Social Trends to access the bonus material. Preface.
If you will see into the heart of a people, look closely at what they create, examine the inventions to which they pay the most attention, read their best-selling books, listen to their popular music, this is how you will know them. Roy H. Williams.
Having made my 90-minute presentation on society's 40-year pendulum to over 240 auditoriums full of people in the past 8 years, I began this book by trying to disprove my own 40-year hypothesis. My friend, Dr. Kerry Mullis, winner of the 1993 Nobel Prize in Chemistry, said,
"Roy, there are few true scientists left in the world. Too often, a scientist will develop a hypothesis and then look for supporting evidence. They identify with their hypothesis and they want it to be correct. But this is bad science. When you have a hypothesis, your job is to try to disprove it. No one knows more about your hypothesis than you do. No one else is as qualified to discover its flaws. When you believe a thing to be true, your first responsibility is to do everything you can to disprove it."
As I attacked my hypothesis to disprove it, I found three major loopholes.
1.
I had chosen the examples in my presentation after I developed my theory.
2.
My presentation was US-centric. I was using the Billboard charts to follow patterns in music and the New York Times bestsellers list to follow patterns in literature.
3.
All my examples came from the past 120 years. My original motive in this was that my audience needed to be familiar with the events. But if my 40-year hypothesis was true, it should be observable in any century. With Carrie's voice ringing in my head, I decided to
A.
throw out all the familiar data in my 90-minute presentation.
B.
begin a new investigation using completely new data, whose patterns and connections I would have no way of knowing in advance.
C.
gather this new data from persons who had never seen my presentation.
D.
use the international hit tracking website T-Sort instead of Billboard.
E.
use the Publisher's Weekly list instead of the New York Times.
F.
examine every 40-year window in the past 3,000 years. And
G.
use a single source, Wikipedia, for establishing the dates of events in question. This book is the result of that investigation.
Roy Williams and I wish to acknowledge our debt to the worldwide teams of unnamed experts who have graciously contributed their time and expertise to these marvelous online endeavors, organizations like Wikipedia and T-Sort. Thank you. Due to the fact that each of these databases is updated daily with new information, it is inevitable that some of the dates will change and that song rankings will be altered. When this occurs, we hope you will retest our hypothesis against the new facts as they are presented and judge for yourself whether our thesis remains reliable.
Introduction.
The key to riding the waves is to understand the forces that move the masses and know approximately when a society will reverse and head back the other direction.
You've seen the public redefine what is acceptable and what is not. But by what process do we choose the new rules? It feels as though the earth is shifting beneath our feet. Having made my living for 30 years as an advertising consultant to small business owners nationwide, I've heard thousands of them practically sing in chorus. Ads that worked well in the past aren't working anymore. What should we do now? What happens next? Where do we go from here? The questions I needed to answer for them were, what are the forces that drive the decisions of the public? What makes people do the things they do? Journey with Michael R. Drew and me as we examine the predictable rhythmic attractions that move a society from one extreme to another. Together, we'll examine where we've been and how we got there. When we get back to where we started, you'll know where society is headed and understand the forces that move us like flotsam on the tide. You'll know exactly how to get in step with the public's expectations. Not only that, you'll be able to stay a step ahead of them. The new rules of success will be clear to you. Predictable, rhythmic attractions are what move our society. Rhythm is intrinsic to the human experience. Feet patter, hearts beat, lungs breathe, planets circle, and seasons cycle to a rhythm. Music, poetry, and dance are built upon it. The yearnings of the heart are cyclical as well. We are rhythmically pulled toward one hunger and away from another. Back and forth we travel, forever dissatisfied, because the hardest choices in life are those that are between two good things. But we don't move between these poles as individuals. We move collectively, as a society. Solomon observed these endless cycles 3,000 years ago and wrote,
"What has been will be again. What has been done will be done again. There is nothing new under the sun. Is there anything of which one can say, 'Look, this is something new'? It was here already, long ago. It was here before our time. No one remembers the former generations, and even those yet to come will not be remembered by those who will follow them." Ecclesiastes, chapter 1, verses 9 through 11.
As you read this book, you'll recall those words of Solomon and think, how very right he was. If only we could learn to examine the experiences of former generations, perhaps we could learn how to avoid taking good things too far. To get the most out of this book, we've added images and charts that will help you apply and understand what we're going to share with you. The Pendulum takes you back in time through the last 3,000 years of history to explore how the 40-year shifts in history have affected Western society. Throughout this book, graphics will show you visually where you are in the pendulum cycle as we transition back and forth from a me cycle to a we cycle.
Chapter 1. Epiphany.
Nick, we just finished 1963 all over again, but this time we're headed in the opposite direction.
What do you mean exactly?
It was late November 2003. I was talking to my friend Dr. Richard D. Grant, a psychologist and teacher of consumer behavior in the MBA program at the University of Texas in Austin. Like many people, I ponder the events of the year each autumn and try to make sense of it all. In the fall of 2003, I had a nagging sense of déjà vu. In 1991, 12 years prior to my strange 1963 all over again proclamation, I had read the Popcorn Report, in which Faith Popcorn suggested, "A trend is a fad that lasts at least 10 years. As those next 10 years progressed, the accuracy of her predictions continued to amaze me. Faith Popcorn's forecasts evolved exactly as she said they would. When you read the Popcorn Report today, her predictions seem fairly obvious. This is due to what Harvard Business School calls the curse of knowledge. You can't imagine not knowing what you know. But if you had read that book in 1991, as I did, those predictions were gutsy, audacious, and profoundly insightful. In one of her closing chapters, Miss Popcorn very presciently describes what we now know as email and e-commerce, though she called them screen mail and info buying, even though neither had yet been invented. When she coined those words, the average American was completely unaware of connectivity. World Wide Web and Internet were terms that were not yet in the common lexicon. It would be another 2 years before the average person would begin hearing rumblings about a soon-to-come information superhighway. Even the most forward-thinking technologists weren't anticipating search engines. In the minds of most people, Faith's claims of screen mail and info buying made her sound like a raving nut. But she was right. I saw these things come to pass. You did too. Solomon's writings in Ecclesiastes and the accuracy of Faith Popcorn's predictions caused me to become sensitive to patterns of events over long periods of time, leading finally to my own November 2003 realization of society's 40-year pendulum. When I explained my theory to Dr. Grant, he pointed me to Generations, the History of America's Future, 1584 to 2069, by William Strauss and Neil Howe. That book gave me the data that showed me I was on solid ground. Strauss and Howe described four generations, each of which lasts about 20 years. The pattern is
1.
Idealist, followed by
2.
Reactive, followed by
3.
Civic, followed by
4.
Adaptive, then back to idealist. However, I was deeply frustrated as I read generations because I didn't see four generations of 20 years each as Strauss and Howe did. I saw two generations of 40 years each. Finally, a few hundred pages into the book, Strauss and Howe described the idealist and the civic generations as dominant, and the reactive and adaptive generations as recessive. That was the moment I began to stitch our two theories together. The dominant 20-year periods mark the upswing of a pendulum, and the recessive 20-year periods mark its downswing as the values that push the pendulum upward begin to run out of steam. Society hungers for individuality and freedom during the upswing of a me. Nothing wrong with that. But we always take a good thing too far. What begins as a beautiful dream of self-discovery, 1963, ends as hollow, phony posing, 1983. And then, from the heady heights of those glittering disco lights, our desires drift quietly back to earth, feather-like, toward what we left behind, working together for the common good. 2 weeks later, I sent the following Monday morning memo to 14,000 subscribers. 1963 all over again. The Monday morning memo for December 15th, 2003. We're about to finish 1963 for the second time. 40 years is how long a true generation stays in power, during which time social change will be evolutionary rather than revolutionary. But in the waning years of each generation, alpha voices ring out as prophets in the wilderness, providing a glimpse of the new generation that will soon emerge like a baby chick struggling to break out of its shell. Prior to 1963, Jack Kerouac's On the Road and J.D. Salinger's Catcher in the Rye were the alpha voices that gave us a glimpse of the emerging baby boomers. The musical alphas that rang out 5 years later, 1958, were Chuck Berry and Elvis Presley. Then, at the tipping point, 1963, we encountered the Beatles, followed by the Rolling Stones, and the world began rapidly changing stripe and color. The passing of the torch from the duty-bound World War II generation into the hands of the do-your-own-thing baby boomers was officially underway. AOL and Google are the Kerouac and Salinger of the new generation that will soon pry the torch from the hands of the boomers reluctant to let it go. Chuck Berry and Elvis Presley have become Tupac Shakur and Eminem, and the baby boomers' reaction to them is much like their own parents' reaction to Chuck and Elvis. But instead of saying, "Take a bath, cut your hair, and get a job," we're saying, "Pull those pants up, spin that cap around, and wash your mouth out with soap." At the peak of the baby boom, there were 74 million teenagers in America, and radio carried a generation on its shoulders. Today, there are 72 million teenagers who are about to take over the world. Do you understand what fuels their passions? Can you see the technological bonds that bind them? baby boomer heroes were always bigger than life, perfect icons, brash and beautiful. Muhammad Ali, Elvis, James Bond. But the emerging generation holds a different view of what makes a hero. Boomers rejected conformity, and their attitude swept to the land, changing even the mores of their fuddy-duddy parents. But today's teens are rejecting pretense. Born into a world of hype, their internal BS meters are highly sensitive and blisteringly accurate. Words like amazing, astounding, and spectacular are translated as blah, blah, and blah. Consequently, tried and true selling methods that worked as recently as a year ago are working far less well today. Trust me, I know. The world is again changing stripe and color. We're at another tipping point. Can you feel it? No one on earth could read Egyptian hieroglyphics until Napoleon Bonaparte discovered the Rosetta Stone in 1799. That stone, nearly 4 feet tall, told the same story in three different languages. Two of those languages we could read. The third language was hieroglyphics. Armed with insights gained from studying the Rosetta Stone, the wealth of a whole society, ancient Egypt, became available to those who took the time to learn the strange new language. If you are concerned about the changes that you see happening all around you, there are basically two things you can do.
One,
pretend that it won't affect your business. Let me know how this works out for you.
Two,
search for a Rosetta Stone that will give you a window into the minds of these barbarians at the gate, so that in the future at least you'll know how to do business with them. If you choose option number two, I believe you'll find the movie 8 Mile, starring Eminem playing himself, to be a pretty good place to start. Should you choose to read Strauss and Howe's Generations, and you should, you will notice that our books do not entirely agree. Having come at the same central idea from two different directions, it is reasonable that we should have two different perspectives. And because our book was written 20 years after theirs, Michael and I have had many more years to contemplate, speculate, and investigate this fascinating sociological phenomenon. With regard to Solomon, Faith Popcorn, William Strauss, and Neil Howe, we can only echo the famous words of Isaac Newton from a letter written to his friend Robert Hooke on February 5th, 1675. If I have seen further than other men, it is only by standing on the shoulders of giants. Thank you, Neil. Thank you, William. Thank you, Faith. Thank you, Solomon. You are our giants.
Chapter 2. Me versus we.
The energies of a duality drive the pendulum of public opinion. On one side is me, the individual, unique, special, and possessing unlimited potential.
1.
Demands freedom of expression.
2.
Applauds personal liberty.
3.
Believes one man is wiser than a million men. A camel is a racehorse designed by a committee.
4.
Wants to achieve a better life.
5.
Is about big dreams.
6.
Desires to be number one. I came, I saw, I conquered.
7.
Admires individual confidence and is attracted to decisive persons.
8.
Believes leadership is look at me, admire me, emulate me if you can. And
9.
Strengthens a society's sense of identity as it elevates attractive heroes.
On the other side is we, the group, the team, the tribe, the collective.
1.
Demands conformity for the common good.
2.
Applauds personal responsibility.
3.
Believes a million men are wiser than one man. Two heads are better than one.
4.
Wants to create a better world.
5.
Is about small actions.
6.
Desires to be a productive member of the team. I came, I saw, I concurred.
7.
Admires individual humility and is attracted to thoughtful persons.
8.
Believes leadership is
This is the problem as I see it. Please consider the things I'm telling you, and perhaps we can solve this problem together. And
9.
Strengthens a society's sense of purpose as it considers all its problems.
Me and we are the equal but opposite attractions that pull society's pendulum one way, then the other. The 20-year upswing of the zenith of the we, as example 1923 to 1943, is followed by a 20-year downswing as that we cycle loses energy, as an example from 1943 to 1963. Society then begins a 20-year upswing into me. Last example would be 1963 to 1983, followed by a 20-year downswing as the me cycle loses energy, 1983 to 2003. Think of the pendulum as the 40-year heartbeat of society, systolic and diastolic. Contract, and the pendulum swings upwards. Relax, and the pendulum swings down again. Although society gets legalistic and judgmental during a we do accomplish a lot of good things, such as raising the flag over Iwo Jima. We let our hair down in a me and become quite a mess because of it, but this gives us a particular joy. For example, Jimmy Buffett's Margaritaville. We and me, it's hard to choose between them. Yes. The hardest choices in life are the choices between two good things, and we always take a good thing too far. The beautiful we dream of working together for the common good gains momentum until it becomes duty, obligation, and sacrifice. What began in joy ends in bondage. This 20-year upswing on the we side of the pendulum is what Strauss and Howe called the civic generation. The years 1923 to 1943 were just such a 20-year upswing. Suffering the consequences of having taken a good thing too far, society begins to fall away from the extreme. The 20-year downswing of the we is what Strauss and Howe called the adaptive generation, from 1943 to 1963. The 40-year pendulum is now back to its central position, the fulcrum, the tipping point halfway between zeniths, ready to swing 20 years up to the opposite side as we take another good thing too far. The beautiful me dream of individual expression, do your own thing, march the beat of a different drummer, gains momentum and refinement until it finally becomes plastic, hollow, phony, and posing. What began in joy now ends in bondage. This 20-year upswing of the me is what Strauss and Howe called the idealist generation. The years 1963 to 83 were just such a 20-year upswing. Again, suffering the consequences of taking a good thing too far, society falls back once again from the extreme. The 20-year downswing of me is what Strauss and Howe called the reactive generation. You and I called it Gen X, 1983 to 2003.
The period of 2003 to 2023 is another upswing of the pendulum.
New York Times columnist David Brooks, writing about students graduating in May of 2011, said,
"Worst of all, they are sent off into this world with the whole baby boomers theology ringing in their ears. If you sample some of the commencement addresses being broadcast on C-SPAN these days, you see that many graduates are told to follow your passion, chart your own course, march to the beat of your own drummer, follow your dreams, and find yourself. This is the litany of expressive individualism. But of course, this mantra misleads on nearly every front."
Brooks further challenged this me idea of finding yourself with a poignant observation.
"Most people don't form a self and then lead a life. They are called by a problem, and the self is constructed gradually by their calling."
Born in 1961, David Brooks is a baby boomer if you cling to the idea of birth cohorts. But Brooks clearly understands the spirit of we. Find a problem and sacrifice yourself to solve it.
"Finally, graduates are told to be independent-minded and to express their inner spirit. But of course, doing your job well often means suppressing yourself. As Atul Gawande mentioned during his countercultural address last week at Harvard Medical School, being a good doctor often means being part of a team, following the rules of an institution, going down a regimented checklist."
Written in the ninth year of a wee upswing, Brooks ends this insightful column with the words,
"The purpose in life is not to find yourself, it's to lose yourself."
Society in a me talks about big dreams and possibilities, but society in a we says, talk is cheap. Don't tell me what you believe, show me. Later in this audiobook, we'll look at everything the current we upswing has meant so far and make a few predictions about what is likely to happen in the future. But right now, let's establish a few definitions. Upswing of the pendulum.
A window of time, approximately 20 years, when the prevailing set of values is gaining momentum in a society. The dominant generations of Strauss and Howe. Idealists, the me, and civic, the we.
Downswing of the pendulum.
A window of time, approximately 20 years, when the prevailing set of values is losing momentum in a society. The recessive generations of Strauss and Howe. The reactive me downswing, and the adaptive we downswing.
Halfway up, halfway down.
The middle of any upswing or downswing, that point in time halfway between the fulcrum and the zenith. The pendulum is in the same position halfway down as it is halfway up. Consequently, the outlook of society will be very much the same.
To share an example, the year 1933 was halfway up a we. In contrast, the year 1953 was halfway down the same we. The attitudes of those years were very similar. Likewise, 1973 was halfway up a me, and 1993 was halfway down the same me. Again, the attitudes and music of those years were very similar. Right now, you might be thinking, upswing 20 years to the zenith of me, then downswing 20 years to the tipping point, then up 20 years to we, then down 20 years to the tipping point would seem to indicate an 80-year pattern rather than only 40 years. This is true, but transformational change happens during a window of just 40 years, between one zenith of the pendulum and another. Consequently, a society becomes an entirely different people every 40 years. If this idea of becoming a new people every 40 years puts an itch of memory into your brain, it's probably because you remember the story of Moses leading Israel through 40 years of wandering through the wilderness.
We're going to talk about that later.
An ocean wave rolls onto the beach. Are you surprised when it rolls back out again? Neither should you be surprised when history repeats itself. The gravity of the moon creates the tides. The momentum of water creates the waves. Me is the gravity of the moon. We is the momentum of water. You'll also notice that we don't name the sides of the pendulum left and right. That's because these words harbor political associations of liberalism and conservatism. Assigning political parties to the sides of the pendulum is a mistake. One might argue, but conservatives fight for the rights of the entrepreneur, the individual me, whereas liberals fight for the benefit of the larger group, trade unions, and the environment, the realm of the collective we. But that's just a single aspect of the conservative-liberal duality. A person might just as easily argue, liberals fight for the right of the individual woman, me, to choose. Conservatives fight for the beliefs of the prevailing religious group, the collective we. See how easy it would be to fall into a semantic debate? If you attempt to assign political beliefs to the swings of the pendulum, you'll become as confused as a termite in a yo-yo. Please resist that temptation. Likewise, we don't call the sides of the pendulum east and west due to the cultural connotations of those words. This, too, would be a mistake. We've done insufficient research to make this statement conclusively, but it would appear that the eastern and western pendulums are locked in opposite cycles. Western Europe, the Americas, and Australia are headed into a we, just as China, India, and the rest of Asia seem to be headed into a me. In essence, China is experiencing the 60s. Our 1963 happened for them in 2003. The November 19, 2007 issue of Newsweek sports a colorful cover drawn in that style that was unique to the 60s. And in the balloon letters of that era, it reads,
1968, the year that made us who we are.
China in 2008 was flexing its muscles in the glorious springtime that is the upswing of every me. Think of the Beijing Olympics of 2008 as the Chinese version of our 1968. As we mentioned earlier, society strengthens its identity in a me as it elevates attractive heroes.
In 2003, the year of the Western tipping point from the downswing of me, 1983 to 2003, into the upswing of our current we, 2003 to 2023, I sent the following Monday morning memo to my few thousand subscribers around the world.
A society and its heroes.
Heroes are dangerous things. Bigger than life, highly exaggerated, and always positioned in the most favorable light. A hero is a beautiful lie. Did George Washington really chop down a cherry tree and then confess to his father? Could Paul Bunyan really do the work of 50 men in a day? Does billionaire Bruce Wayne really risk his life to help the less fortunate around him? We have historic heroes, folk heroes, and comic book heroes. We have heroes in books, in songs, in movies, and in sport. We have heroes of morality, leadership, kindness, and excellence. And nothing is so devastating to our sense of well-being as a badly fallen hero. Yes, heroes are dangerous things to have. The only thing more dangerous is not to have them. Heroes raise the bar we jump and hold high the standards we live by. They are ever-present tattoos on our psyche, the embodiment of all we're striving to be. We create our heroes from our hopes and dreams, and then they attempt to create us in their own image. It's funny when you think about it. We tell the lie of George Washington and the cherry tree to impress on our children the importance of honesty. We boast of the exploits of Paul Bunyan to communicate the beauty of productivity and the power of a work ethic. And really, wouldn't the world be a better place if all its billionaires were as selfless as Bruce Wayne? But as the romantic and misty-eyed baby boomers shuffle off the American stage, they're being replaced by a clear-eyed generation who believes in keeping it real, saying always, "Take a good look, dog, 'cause you ain't all that." So now we put our politicians under a microscope because we won't accept less than the bitter truth. Could JFK have survived the scrutiny we imposed on poor Bill Clinton? The dysfunctional Malcolm in the Middle has replaced television's idyllic John Boy Walton, and a reality show has replaced Sunday night's Wonderful World of Disney. But as we reject artificiality and hype, are we also killing off all our heroes? 299 years ago, Andrew Fletcher understood the transforming power of heroes. In his 1704 speech from the floor of the Scottish Parliament, he pleaded for the creation of myths and legends to inspire the Scottish people, saying, "Who should make the laws of a nation?" And we find that most of the ancient legislators thought they could not well reform the manners of any city without the help of a lyric and sometimes of a dramatic poet. Yes, every hero is a beautiful lie, but then so is every dream until it becomes reality. Roy H. Williams.
Chapter 3. What defines a generation?
The classic definition of generation in modern conversation is birth cohorts, people born between a certain year and another certain year. Using this classic definition of generation, a glance online will tell you that baby boomers are considered those people born between 1946 and 1964. Gen Xers were born either between 1965 and 1976, between 1965 and 1980, or between 1961 and 1981, depending on who is talking. Millennials, also called Generation Y, Generation Next, Net Generation, Echo Boomers, the 9/11 generation, and the Facebook generation, were born between 1977 and 1998, or from 1978 and 2000. Catherine Colbert, a writer for Bismology, says, "Millennials in general were born between 1980 and 2005. But then, her next words hit the bullseye. The age of this group isn't as important as its attitude." God bless Colbert. She seems to have realized that anyone who sees the world through the eyes of a millennial and makes judgments and evaluations according to the values of a millennial should rightfully be called a millennial. It's not about age. It's about attitude. It's not about when you were born. It's about how you see the world. In this book, the word generation will be defined as life cohorts bonded by a set of values that dictate the prevailing worldview of the majority. Life cohorts, not birth cohorts. Everyone alive, regardless of their age, who sees the world through the lens of a particular set of values is part of that generation. Very few people see the world today as they saw it in 1971.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.